Okay.
I'd like to know what your feelings are about the Tea Party movement. And I have a feeling that with the amount of executive orders this president has issued, has that made our Senate irrelevant?
Good questions. I'm grateful to the Tea Party movement. The Tea Party movement held us accountable as Republicans. We lost our way in the 2000s. Republicans in the Senate and the House started spending like Democrats used to. So the budget deficits during the 2000s, with Republican control, piled up and up and up. Now, it's far worse now under Democratic control. The deficits of the past 2 years are more than the past 8 years combined. But the Tea Party held us accountable. And I was in the Senate when the Tea Party really started to take shape. And I can tell you a lot of the old-timers were very worried and didn't understand it. So I'm pleased with the Tea Party movement for the vigor. Look, anytime an American shows up and cares about their government and wants to get us back to first principles, I think that's a good thing. The second thing is about these executive orders. They are diminishing the role of Congress. And they're unconstitutional in many ways. I think a lot of what government does is unconstitutional. The National Labor Relations Board. I don't remember seeing that in my copy of the Constitution. I don't remember seeing that a body can have legislative, judicial, and executive power all in one and not be elected. And you've got this National Labor Relations Board. You have an acting general counsel who was not confirmed by the U.S. Senate, who is telling Boeing that they cannot hire 1,000 people in South Carolina because of his interpretation of labor laws. It's wrong. It's unconstitutional. There's all sorts of things in government that are. But we're not going to fix these things until we have a Republican-controlled Senate. We're not going to fix these things until we have a Republican president. What I realized about the presidency is this, and I spent time with the president, I spent time with these agency heads. It's not just the president who you elect. It's all the people that come with him. And these unelected people in these agencies are tremendously powerful. Lisa Jackson at EPA is wreaking havoc on our state. Killing our commercial, the marine fisheries people are killing our commercial fishermen. Lisa Jackson with this numeric nutrient standard, which is going to hurt our farmers, hurt our phosphate mining, increase the cost of water for cities and municipalities, which means you, based on bogus science. I stopped it and held it up while I was there, but then I left because my time was over. But that's just one example of what these people who have come with President Obama are doing and how they are unleashed against business and against consumers in this country.
I have a two-part question as well.
Yes, ma'am.
The first one is, will you stand with Israel?
Absolutely. Can I answer a little bit
about
it?
Absolutely.
You know, I'm a 100% supporter of Israel. I was in the Senate, and I will be again. These people believe in what we believe in. They believe that we have God-given rights. They believe in free press. They believe in the right to criticize your government. They believe in the right to select your government. They are in a sea of despotism. And this administration treats our friends like our enemies, and our enemies like our friends. And it's outrageous. And we got to stop trying to be the neutral arbiter, alleged neutral arbiter, of these disputes between people who don't believe in what we believe in and our friends. This president came out and said that Israel should go back to its pre-1967 borders. It's like saying America should go back to the 13 colonies. It's outrageous. And it's political suicide for Israel to give back the Golan Heights and these other areas and to shrink down inside. It's political suicide. We got to be on the side of our friends. We don't need a foreign policy. We need a freedom policy. And when a country believes in what we believe in, they're our friends, and we support them. And when they don't, we got to really think second, give a second look to it, and think hard about why we're supporting them with money or military funding or whatever it is. Because that's a Cold War strategy. You know, it used to be us against the Soviet Union. If you were against the Soviet Union, we'd help you because we were in this one-on-one struggle. The world's not like that anymore. So I'm 100% supportive of Israel. Bill Nelson has said nothing about the president's statement about Israel. Nothing. Nothing. I mean, even Harry Reid came out and said the president was wrong. Bill Nelson, silent.
Thank you. My other question is about Agenda 21. You mentioned Lisa Jackson and the EPA. I think that's one of the strongest instruments that's being used against us today to implement the UN's Agenda 21. Your comments?
I'm concerned about Agenda 21. If I become your senator again, I will be vigilant against it. I'm not for world law. I'm not for the United Nations telling us how to live our life. You know, we're going to live the way we want to live in this country. We believe in private property rights. It's a fundamental value in this country. And people need to be able to live the way they want to live. And the people who make those decisions are, you know, the government that should be the most involved is your local government, not your state, not your feds. That's what our founders intended. But at the end of the day, it's the individual, it's the citizen. And anytime the government is doing something to you, you're taking away your freedom. So I will be vigilant against Agenda 21 and things like it.
I have three things that I'd like to speak about. Three things. What are your opinions on illegal immigration, border control, and NAFTA?
We have a real illegal immigration problem in this country. And we've got to secure our borders. I went to Arizona when I was in the Senate with Senator Kyle, who's a senator from Arizona. And we toured the border from Yuma on the west to Douglas on the east. I was either walking on the ground, in a Jeep, in a helicopter, or in a plane, and I saw the entire border. I went to places where we are stopping illegal immigration with great effect. In Yuma, they've stopped it by 95%. Because they built a wall, they got folks monitoring the wall. When you come over the wall, they arrest you, they try you, they put you in jail. And they killed you there for at least 90 days. And then when they put you back in Mexico, they don't put you right back where you came over, they put you way into the interior. So people are 100 miles away or 200 miles away from where they crossed. It works. But there's other places like Nogales and others, and Douglas, where I met a rancher whose brother was murdered, where it's not working. We've got to spend the money to secure the border. No nation, whether it's Papua New Guinea or the United States of America, can be secure if it can't secure its own border. We've got to have the promise of legal immigration. We've got to fix that too, by the way. You know, our immigration system is so screwed up. Immigration should be like recruiting. We should be bringing the people here. We want to be here, right? Whether we want them, whether they're a scientist or whether they're people who are going to work on a farm and be here for 6 months and then go home, let's be thoughtful and sensible about how we do this and not let people just come here, more than 10 million people here illegally. Now, Florida's problem is different than Arizona's problem. When people say, I want an Arizona-style immigration solution, it's not really the right thing for Florida because our problem is wholly different. We don't have a border problem. We have a visa overstay problem. People come here legally, and then they stay illegally. And here's the answer. They got to go home. They got to go back to where they came from. And we got to change this immigration law that allows some people from some countries to stay because there was an earthquake 20 years ago, and people in the country next door don't get to stay. It doesn't make any sense. So I'm for border security, and I'm for strengthening our immigration laws. But you had two other things. NAFTA, what was the other one?
NAFTA was the, what is your opinion of NAFTA as it's being implemented in the United States?
I'm for free trade, but I'm for fair trade too. And I'm not for China, for example, taking all of our intellectual property, ripping it off, and then sending all the products back in the world when we invest in all the research and development. Look, we've got to have more American jobs. We've got to put Americans back to work. One of the things I would do if you sent me back to the Senate is I would propose legislation to cut taxes to create jobs. And I would do that in two ways. One is, we've cut payroll taxes for employees. That's good. We should do it for employers. Every time they hire a new employee, they should get a tax break. That would create incentive to hire. Second thing is, let's create an investment tax credit like President Kennedy did in the 60s. And if you buy a piece of equipment made by Americans, or you hire some American workers, you would get a tax incentive. That would put people back to work. Marco Rubio's right. We need more taxpayers, not more taxes. We need more people working. Sir, behind you, this lady, and then I'll get to you.
I have a question about foreign aid, if you can comment on that, and about the 140 military installations we have around the world. Should we continue with that?
We have foreign aid. We spend a lot of money on it. In the grand scheme of things, it is not a tremendous amount of money. Know this about your budget. 85% of what the federal government spends money on is Medicare, Medicaid, Social Security, and defense. 85%. That's where the real money is. But it's not insignificant. And my point earlier about where the money should go, it needs to go to people who share our values. Right? Now, there's going to be some people we're going to probably have to give some money to that we're trying to bring over to our values. But it needs to be limited. We're going broke. We can't be building schools in other countries when we're going broke here. We gotta take care of America first. I'm not for getting rid of all of it, but we gotta be a lot more sensible about it. And ma'am, your second thing was?
About the military installations.
Look, we've gotta be strong around the world. I'm a big believer in our military and our foreign policy. But there's military installations that we don't need anymore, and we certainly don't need them in the size that they're in. Do we need 30,000 plus people in Germany? I don't think so. Doesn't mean we leave Germany completely. Do we need them in Korea? Yes. We do need them in Korea, because North Korea is crazy and dangerous, and they're near China. And we need to be able to make sure that we have a presence in Southeast Asia. But besides bases, we have these combatant commands. You know, we have all of these commands that are mini pentagons around America and around the world that have all the same bureaucracies. Let me tell you a little story. I showed up when I was first there in the Senate. I went to the Army breakfast. Very excited about this. Senate Army breakfast. And I walk in the room, and I start seeing all these generals. And they all have 4 stars. And it was like 20 of them. Now I'm thinking Patton, MacArthur, Eisenhower, right? He had 5. But I think, you know, how many people have 4 stars? There's a ton of 4-star officers in our military. The military is a bureaucracy, too. And we as Republicans are not going to be credible about spending cuts unless we come truthfully to the fact that we got to cut spending in the military. That there's plenty of waste, plenty of inefficiency, and plenty of duplication in the military too. So I believe that you can save a lot of money, hundreds of billions of dollars over a 10-year period by cutting military spending without affecting force readiness and without affecting the security of this country.
Ladies and gentlemen.